Today's show is pre-recorded.
Y'all know what time it is.
Y'all don't know, y'all better act somebody.
Hat on,
suit on,
looking
like the dapper dawn,
giving a microphone,
dress
like the $1 million,
buttons,
things in its cuffs.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all tell me, who could it be but Steve Harvey?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody out there listening to me.
Mm-hmm.
Put your hands together for Steve Harvey.
Put your hands together.
Good morning, everybody. You are listening to The Voice. Come on, dig me now. One and only Steve Harvey. Got a radio show. I thank God for it every day. I try to remember that, too. You know, I try to remember to be grateful. I think gratitude is one of the things that helps keep me grounded. You can go as far as you want in life if you don't mind who gets the credit. Well, that applies to God, too, don't it? I mean, you know, really, if you don't mind who gets the credit, I'm surrounded by very competent people. I'm surrounded by a lot of people who work hard on their jobs, on their career, who are dedicated employees and also just dedicated to their families and, you know, dedicated to their own set of aspirations. I don't expect anybody to work for me forever. I always look at my job opportunities as stepping stones. Because I want everyone around me really to aspire to be more. I mean, that's really the way I am. I'm not any other way. I'm not trying to hold you to this position, you know, tell you there's no room for growth, any of that. But even though I'm surrounded by these people, I'm grateful that God placed them in my path, in my life, but in my mind, in my spirit, in everything in me, the credit still belongs to God. I'm sorry. The credit still belongs to God. See, if you would just for a moment stop thinking about yourself, just for a moment, I know that's hard, but just for a moment, stop thinking about yourself and realize that maybe you are who you are. Because God is who he is. Maybe that's the case. Have you ever considered that? That's the strongest possibility I can give to you. You know, how do you think you the one that made it through? How you think you the one after all of the ignorant decisions we have made? And oh my goodness, let's all be honest. Ain't we made some crazy decisions? I'm talking about, man, I have made decisions so adverse to my destiny and career, my promises. I've made some decisions, man, knowingly, you hear me? Knowingly do something wrong. And in spite of all that, I'm still here standing. Okay, come on now. Really? Really? All the dirt you done. Everybody done dirt. All the mistakes you've made. You in the position you in today. because of what? Because you all that? Because you work harder than anybody else? Look, I work hard. I'll tell you in a minute I work hard, but I don't think I'm the hardest working person out there. I'm pretty sure somebody done worked way harder than I have. So, okay, so you work hard. Okay, cool. I got all that. But man, what about his grace and his mercy? What about his favor? How many times, man, you done relied on that even when you ain't know you was relying on it? How many times, man, God done shown you mercy? You ain't even deserve it. Do you know how many things I've done wrong? I just ain't get caught at it. let me see how simple I can be here. You speed, you jaywalk, you lie to police when you get pulled over that you wasn't speeding. You go to court and argue you wasn't speeding when you was. You make U-turns. I'm just doing traffic violations. Now, let's get off traffic for a second. Let's get on human violations. You talk about people when you're not supposed to. You indulge yourself in gossip even when you don't really have all the facts. You pass judgment. You lust for people that don't belong to you. You say things to people that you're not supposed to say. So, look, all of us, we all guilty now. See, I'm not saying you do all of that, but I'm saying I'm pretty sure I hit you somewhere in there. Just somewhere in there. You done lied before. You know, you lied recently. I mean, come on. I'm just saying. So with all that in mind, see, I'm just looking at the little things that we do that we don't get busted for. Not to mention the chips you stole when you was a kid and nobody caught you. Well, that elevated, didn't it? And some of y'all just didn't stop stealing. And next thing you know, you was in a car. Now you're sitting somewhere you don't want to be sitting because of a decision you made. But through his grace and mercy, couldn't it have been worse, though? Without his grace and mercy, could not it have been worse? I know two dudes that got caught in the garage one time trying to break in somebody's house, and the person in the house they broke into just happened to have a gun and held them in the garage, caught them, and held them to the garage till the police came. That's grace and mercy right there, because they had all full right to shoot these two people, but they didn't. They're grace and mercy. See, all of us have benefited from his grace and mercy. All of us have done a wrong, committed a sin, broken a law, and somehow through his grace and mercy got by. Doing drugs, buying drugs, slanging drugs, doing something, got by. Jumped on somebody for no reason, got by. You know, so see, how you figure with all that can go on in your life? And then, hold on, let me throw a couple more at you. You can't wake yourself up in the morning, Mr. Big Shot. You don't have the ability to control the breaths that you take. Really, Mr. Big Shot. Really. Let's get real basic with it now. You can't wake yourself up in the morning. That's favor. That's grace. That's mercy. That's him allowing you to wake up. Just hoping we get it right. You know, God spared me through all the dirt I was doing, just hoping one day, man, can you just straighten up a little bit? When I finally straightened up, and I'm going to just say it, straightened up a little bit. See, I ain't straightened up all the way. See, I ain't going to sit here and tell you that. I just straightened up a little bit. He started blessing me. So the more blessings I got, I started going, man, maybe I'll try straightening up a little bit more. So I straightened up a little bit more. Now, I still got a long way to go, but I'm straighter than I was. Now, when people judging me, and as they will and they do, because that ain't right, but they do, and I ain't walking just the way they walk, then here come the criticism. I get it all the time. Stop wanting credit all the time and give out some credit where credit is due. Instead of having somebody patting you on your back all the time, why don't you tell people it was God, man, that you don't really know how you made it, that really, man, you have no explanation for your success, or you have no explanation why you still existing today. Why don't you tell somebody it was God today? Don't be ashamed. It's the truth, ain't it? I mean, really, man, let's give God some credit here. Give God the credit and the glory and the honor. And like that plaque said, you can go as far as you want in life if you don't mind who gets the credit. All right.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Folks, I have something to say. I do every morning, but this is different. Not that it's a different day. It's another Monday. Not that I'm going to say something you've never heard, because I'm assuming that you're well-versed in the skill set of English. I cannot put words together that you've never heard before. So why would I need your undivided attention when I know that all of you are familiar with every single piece of verbiage that I could possibly put together? So what I will attempt to do is take you down a road of verbiage that is uncomfortable. Here it is. When about to give off into this here show that there, that y'allins done come in his folk. And his folk, and furthermore, here it is that we about to pop it off and let them get off into that thing. Ladies and gentlemen, protrusions and exclusions, put it together for the Steve Harvey Morning Show. That's a damn intro right there. What? What? Huh? That's English. All that's English. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the greatest Ebonic intros of all time, Shirley Strawberry. I know your ears is bleeding.
Out of bed, yeah. Good morning.
Carla, for real.
You toe it up. Good morning.
Toe up. From the flow up, ladies and gentlemen, Kier Spates, we call him Junior.
Well, you said that there.
I know I did, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the bitter man himself, J. Anthony Brown.
You definitely did the damn thing, sir. Yes, you did. You did it.
Ladies and gentlemen, king of pranks, Nephew Tommy.
Top, Uncle Steve.
Riding, baby. Riding. Yeah. So right.
Every day you're you're in a singing mood, always in the morning.
Oh man, I'd be so happy that God wake me up.
Mm-hmm. I know that's right.
I'd be like, come on, man.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Another one? Amen again.
I'd woke up a lot of days, dog. I'd wake up a whole lot of times. Uh-huh. And I remember the times that I would wake up and not quite be feeling it, and I would give in to it. You know, and go, oh, I got up on the wrong side of the bed. Well, I stopped that long time ago. Ain't no wrong side of the bed, man. Long as I get up, man, I don't give a damn if I roll up and slam dead into a damn wall. But then that's another thing. I ain't had a bed up against a wall in a long-ass time. Yeah. My bed ain't been up against a wall in a long, long time.
It's just in the middle of the floor.
It's just out in the open.
What? Yeah, no, it was just you know, you just get in on either side. Yeah. You know.
Oh, I see.
It was up against the wall.
Okay. You know what I mean? Okay. All of your beds, you can get in from both sides. All of you. Yeah. So don't act like it's just me. Stop.
No. Except if you're in the W Hotel,
ain't nothing rich about that at all.
It wasn't a rich moment, a champagne moment.
All right. Coming up at 32 minutes after the hour, we'll talk more. To the crew, and we'll ask the CLO right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, Steve, time for Ask the CLO. Here we go. This one is from Marnisha in South Dallas. She writes, I'm 33 years old and happily married to my high school sweetheart. He's 34 and very active with our son's athletic programs. Our son is 14, and he's acting like our son could go to the NFL or the NBA any day now. He has our son taking all kinds of supplements. He has a trainer and a strength coach. I see my son wanting to hang out with his friends, and he has a few girls he's talking to. My husband means well, but I want to ask him to give our son a break. How do I do this without offending him?
Well, you know, I think the question is, how does your son feel about it? Mm-hmm. You know? Because the one thing about special athletes, they kind of be special as children. Some athletes blossom late, but most of these guys, you can see it early on that they got something special. He may be enjoying it. Mm-hmm. Now, supplements at 14,
that's crazy.
Don't know what you're talking about now. I don't know what supplement you taking at 14, man, that you even
take
need because, yeah, I mean, your body is growing and developing anyway every day at 14. Now, you get older, you need supplements to supplement what's starting to diminish. You might take a testosterone supplement. You might take a mineral supplement. But at 14, you ain't missing nothing. That's the only thing I think is crazy. But, you know, your boy playing sports for girls anyway. You ain't got to worry about them girls. He had them.
That's not going to stop right there.
No, you ain't got to worry about that. He got telephone, FaceTime, computers. Oh, no, quit worrying about the girls, lady.
Yeah, way more than what we had, that's for sure.
Man.
They talk about him on the phone.
Yeah. Man, please. Come on, don't worry
about
that. All
right, moving on. I'm with Sydney in Richmond.
Keep up busy.
Sydney in Richmond says, last week I met Sydney in Richmond. Okay. Said I met the most beautiful girl last week. Beautiful girl I've ever seen. And within a week, she's fallen off the face of the earth. She told me she goes to a certain coffee shop every morning, so I showed up there. We'd been talking on the phone a few days, so I figured it was okay to show up and treat her to coffee. She would not get out of the car, and she drove off. That's when she stopped answering my calls. What happened within a week to cause this?
She saw you.
Yeah. That was it. That's
yeah, she saw you. Yeah. Yeah, she saw you, dog. All that talking on the phone. She saw you, dog. It's all good. Don't even worry about it, man. Sydney, that's what happened, man. You know, when you have something about you that they don't like, they're not getting out the car.
What's wrong?
She ain't
gonna
waste none of her time. You know, he ugly. He know that.
Sydney, he ugly.
You know, he got a name that kind of leads towards, you know, you ain't cute. I ain't never seen cute Sydney. Unless it was a girl. I done seen a lot of fine chicks named Sydney, but most dudes named Sydney look just like Sydney. Sydney. You know, dog. You know what was happening. You know what's happening, dog. It's either that or you ain't the right height. I don't want to get into that on this show this morning, but I'm just talking about Sydney.
Oh, not today.
It's either you look or you wasn't the right height.
One of the two.
When she pulled up.
Short and ugly. Could have been short and ugly.
Because if you were standing next to the mailbox and she couldn't tell which one was which.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to move on. I think Sydney gets the point. Yeah.
Short and wide as a mailbox.
All right, here we go. Patrick
just
in the Bahamas.
Just look like a little FedEx drop box. Go
Will
ahead.
You move on?
Patrick in the Bahamas says, I'm a 48-year-old single man, and I was dating a slightly younger female that was insecure. She accused me of messing around every time I left the house. One night, I was headed to the movies with my sons, and she said if I left, she'd be gone when I got back. I told her to go ahead and leave. She tried to hit me, and I ducked, so she spit in my face.
Oh,
I lost it. I picked her up and put her outside my house, and I locked her out. I took all of her things to her mom's house, and she told her mom that I put my hands on her. Do I defend myself or let her play the victim? Wow.
Wow.
I mean, you're going to have to defend yourself with that he put his hands on me, you know. But once you spit on me, you got to get out.
Yeah.
We're immediately.
Forever.
I mean,
right
that's
now.
Just a hateful ass move.
Yeah.
It is.
For no reason? Because you're going out with your sons? Wow.
I mean, you're going to the movie with your sons. You can't do that? Hey, bro, she insecure. She ain't that fine. Dog, let her go now.
Yeah.
She spit on you.
And you put your hands on her when you picked her up and physically set her outside.
Yeah.
So she got a technicality on you. But as long as you don't hit her, dog.
Can I spit back, though? I got to do something.
Well, I'm not going to do that. I'm not hitting a woman and I'm not spitting on a woman. I'm not kicking. I don't do nothing physical to a woman. And I've had some stuff done to me.
Woo.
But I will not. I will not do anything physical to a woman simply because of the way I was raised.
That's an all-time low right there.
Yeah, I'm not spitting on you, none of that.
Can we put a bookmark in there where you said I've had some things done to me and revisit that at some point? Because I'd like to know.
Oh, I've been slapped with a raw chicken breast. Yeah, I've been.
That's my favorite.
What did you do? What did you do to get slapped
that's
with a raw
favorite,
chicken breast?
Steve.
I don't even remember. I've done a lot, but I, you know, the raw chicken breast, that wasn't necessary.
I wouldn't want chicken no more after that.
I had a pot thrown at me and the handle stuck in the wall. I've been kicked. I've had a pitcher of water thrown on me in a bed. I done had everything, dog. I ain't never hit a woman.
Pitcher of water?
Huh? I thought
was
I was drowning.
Was the chicken seasoned when you got hit with it? Was that? I'm just curious.
It was just raw, fresh out the pack.
Raw, just a raw chicken.
I'm going to tell you something, though, dog. I don't care who you are, that's nice ass stang.
Oh, it stung?
Did it leave a mark? I just wanted to know, Steve. All right, coming up next, Church Complaints with Reverend Motown and Deacon Def Jam right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Coming up at the top of the hour in trending news, we'll talk about Vax Attack, the viral video of the restaurant hostess being attacked in New York City. Also in entertainment news, the iHeartRadio Music Festival was big over the weekend in Las Vegas, and one of the kings of comedy, Cedric the Entertainer, hosted the Primetime Emmys last night. We'll talk about all of these stories at the
big
top
dog.
Of the hour. Yeah.
He had a funny-ass promo, man.
Yeah.
Right now, it's Monday. It's time for Church Complaints with Reverend Motown and Deacon Def Jam.
We fourth gal. Auspiciously, as we reconcile with our reciprocity of engagement of dualities, we carnivorously.
Oh, that's a new one there. Now that's new.
Postulate in a way where we. Remindful.
Re what?
Remindfully.
Remindfully.
Fourth righteousness.
Ooh, you scared me with that long F. Go ahead.
Come on. Pitulate. I'm preaching now. Let us begin, Deacon, with church complaints.
All
I know
right,
it's so hard to follow that, but go ahead.
Yeah. Let's see here. Sister Princess Banks. You know Sister Princess Banks. Her son, Jacoby, slammed his door after she told him to clean his room. Let me just cut to the chase and say her bail is set at $5,000. she's been charged with arson. She burnt the whole dough down. Do we bail her out or what do we do, pal? But that's sister.
Well, her bail is
Banks.
Set as $5,000. That's $500. I'm going to go get her out because we support this type of thing. I remember when I was a boy, I slammed the door and I went to school and came home and the door was removed.
Yes.
Yeah.
You won't slam no more.
Wait a minute. The whole door was completely gone?
Hinge and everything.
It was just an opening to your
and
room.
Painted.
I painted.
Looked like an archway. I no longer had privacy the entire time I stayed there. So, yes, we will get a 500 and get out of that.
All right, 500 for Sister Princess Banks. All right, let's move right along here, Pastor. The roller skating ministry wants to use the parking lot for practice. But we got too many potholes in the parking lot. Now, Crazy Legs on the roller skating ministry said the money you spend on your cigars monthly could pay to fix the parking lot. Now, I'm not getting in the middle of that, but I'm just saying that's what Crazy Legs is saying.
You can tell Crazy Legs go to hell. And now let's deal with the resurfacing of the parking lot. Crazy Legs is the only slim skater that we have.
All right.
It is the sheer weight of the membership on skates. Uh-huh. Sister Earlene cracked the entire parking lot with new rollerblades. See, you got to spread that weight out on four wheels. When she put it on them rollerblades, she just cracked up that entire parking lot. Now, we got to resurface that thing. And what I want to say to Crazy Legs is, you stop letting everybody come on this parking lot skate now. We're going to put a scale at the gate. And if you're over 250, you can't skate. That's all to it.
It's a 250 limit for the skate 250. Ministry. Roller skating or 250.
I know nine people can't come right now. Ain't no way in hell they're going to be able to get down 250 by Saturday.
Well, you're cutting the ministry down now, Pastor. I don't know if they're going
to. It ain't a ministry. It's roller skating.
They call it a roller skating ministry now. I don't know if they're skating for the Lord or what, but they call it.
It's not a ministry, Deacon. I'm not going to say it no more.
Oh, you
quit calling it what it ain't.
What
in case you want to know who I'm hollering at, the answer is you.
Why are you taking a tone with me, though, Pastor? I'm not even in that tone.
Listen to me. Did you see the movie The Godfather?
Yes, I did.
When Corleone told Sonny, the one that bring it to you.
Uh-huh.
And is you not the one that's bringing it?
I'm bringing it, but I don't want you to kill the messenger.
In here with the complaint because you think you want me to do something about it. I told you, we not finna do that. 250, that's it. That's all I got.
250 weight limit, roller skating ministry. Let me move right along. I know you want to hear this or not. Brother Larry Elder wants to join the church to get closer to black people. He came Sunday, and sat on the pew, and everyone moved when he sat on it. And then he ran up into the choir stand, and everybody stopped singing. He wants you to make them like him. Now, I don't know if you can handle this, Pastor, but that's Brother Larry Elder. He wants to join the church.
I think the best way to sum this up is last week, we were discussing Larry Elder. Well, not we, but they were discussing him on the morning show.
That's right.
J. Anthony Brown made a point that I really stuck with me.
What was that, Pat?
A homeless person threw a egg at Larry Elder.
Yes, they did. Hurled it.
Now, you got to be nothing for a homeless, hungry person to hurl a whole meal at you.
That's right.
That egg could have sustained him for another day. He was willing to sacrifice another day of living. In the words of Rare Earth, I just want to celebrate another day of living. I just want to celebrate another day of life.
You just want to sing this song.
You better let him use you. When a homeless man, in the words of J. Anthony Brown, throws an egg away at you, you know how hard it was for him to get that egg? How hard it is for a homeless person to hold on to an egg?
Protein,
you got to sleep right. You got to fight off robberies. Larry Allen not going to be a member of this church.
No.
And we have a multicultural church, but we have blacks, browns, and whites. We don't have no Uncle Tom.
All right, on that note, we got to say this. Coming up at the top of the hour, we'll have some entertainment and national news for you right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
The iHeartRadio Music Festival was big this past weekend in Las Vegas. Carla, what you got? What happened? Tell us all the good news.
That's right, Shirley. The two-day. It was a two-day festival. The two-day iHeartRadio Musical Festival returned back to the T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas this past weekend. Shirley, Monica, we've all been out there. It was star-studded with our guy, Nelly.
Nelly
was fire. He set the stage on fire. Billy Eilish, J. Cole, Khalid, Can We Just Talk? Hip-hop rappers Lil Baby, J. Cole, Sweetie, and rock and roll legend, the band member Journey, Don't Stop Believing. They were really, really good. They closed out the show. So if you missed it and you want to check it out, make sure you watch the CW Network on October 2nd and 3rd, the iHeartRadio Music Festival. Doing it big. Congratulations, iHeart. What you got, Shirley?
I want to see Nelly. Thank you, Carla.
Yes, yes.
All right, in more entertainment news, so Steve, we have to give a big shout out to our friend, friend of the show, your personal friend, one of the kings of comedy, Cedric the Entertainer, Ceddie said hosted the 73rd annual Primetime Emmys last night. He was looking good. It was star-studded. Ballerina Misty Copeland, Michael Douglas, Taraji P. Henson, Gail King,
LL. He was
LL.
Good, man, because Ced was himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's what I like, man. He was really good. He did a great job, man.
Yeah.
That's your boy, huh? There, that's your friend.
That's my dude, cool. Man.
Sweet dude.
I don't care what he do, I pull for him. You know, that's
absolutely
cool.
Yeah.
You know, Cap.
What happened?
Hey. Don't downplay that.
What'd you say, Steve? You mumbled it.
Yeah, I said it was Cap.
Oh.
He's a Kappa. Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. Yes, he is. Proud
you
member.
Want him to be a Q with you.
Everybody
it wouldn't even look right being a Q. That don't even look good.
That don't look good on set.
That don't well right.
Have been no Q. We know that.
Okay, and let's see.
No,
because you already knew. I was over there waiting. That's why you ain't want to come, Q. You ain't want to come this route because you know I was in. I was already waiting.
Okay, what was you going to do to me you ain't already done with me growing up? You pledged me for 20-something years. What was you going to do to me that you ain't already done?
As a nephew?
So much more.
You just act like he wasn't even your nephew. You didn't even know
I was not fitting to let, please.
All right, we're going to move on that note. Finally, in trending video gone viral news, vax attack. New York City was concerned that its new mandate requiring people to show proof of COVID vaccinations to enter restaurants and other indoor venues would result in some ugly confrontations. And guess what? That's just what happened in a chaotic video now gone viral. Three women from Houston, Texas, tried to get into, everybody knows Carmine's in New York, the popular tourist restaurant there. These women got violent when the hostess outside asked to see proof of vaccination. The women started hitting the hostess with punches and also ripped off her necklace. It was horrible. Wow. Restaurant staff and even some bystanders intervened to try to break up the fight. Police were called in and three women were arrested, thank God. Just FYI, New York City's rule requiring proof of vaccination for indoor restaurants, dining, gym, all that entertainment venues has been in effect since August 17th. But according to multiple outlets, the rule has just recently started
to
be enforced.
In L.A. too.
Well, here's the deal. You don't want to get the vaccine, that's fine. I mean, cool. You know, if you don't want to get the vaccine, okay, cool. But the people who have decided to be safe, you can't put them at risk. Sorry.
Yeah, and she didn't make the rule.
She's doing her job.
She just worked there.
Asking, yeah.
I mean, you mad at her because you ain't got no vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
All she doing, she just a host at the restaurant.
Yeah.
Her boss told her to check everybody for a vaccine card.
And now your ass going to jail and your meal's going to really change. the meal you was going
to
get.
Yeah, what you about to eat.
Ain't no appetizer. Ain't no appetizer at all.
Ain't no appetizer and ain't no menu.
Ain't no fettuccine Alfredo. All that.
I'm telling you by experience, it is cold as hell. You can't say warm this up. They don't want to hear that, okay?
You get what you get.
That ain't what I wanted today.
Oh. Okay.
Wow. Terrible. It's really bad.
Ignorant.
They almost knocked the podium down.
You saw the video? I saw it.
I saw that video. I saw
somebody sent me the video. I
saw it. It was
seen.
Crazy.
Okay.
Mm. Yeah, it's crazy. Guys,
no, I haven't seen. Somebody sent me a video.
They just acted like... It's like, what? You jump on this, and she's a young woman. You jump on her because she asked you a question about a vaccine? Are you serious?
That's the thing.
About your car?
At what point do you think when you whipping the hostess ass that mm-hmm. they gonna give you a seat? Where does
yeah,
this seat
they're gonna work? Yeah, right, Jay. They're gonna let you in.
Why ain't nobody helping me with this ass whipping though? There's a lot of people work here now. Somebody got to come on and help me with this ass whipping.
It was so unbelievable. I'm pretty sure people are in shock at first, and then you go. Oh my God! They're beating her up. You know, they've jumped on her.
He paid for that. Beat the lady up.
Three sisters from Houston. Though that's a hell of an ass whooping. I'm telling you. That's a strong one.
Well, all right. Well, coming up at 20 minutes after the hour, we're going to look into the mind of J. Anthony Brown. Right after this,
you're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, Steve, introduce your boy.
Ladies and gentlemen, J. Anthony Brown.
Thank you so much, Mr. Harvey. My question today, I have two sets of questions.
Ain't nobody said nothing but me.
I'm just saying thank you. I have two sets of questions for two groups of people. The first question is to the men who have a nice head of hair.
Okay.
A nice size head of hair. But...
Junior.
The question is, how much forehead is allowed?
Junior.
Why did you put me in here?
I need to know how.
Wait a minute.
If you,
well, you know,
if you have a nice set of, if
come
you
on,
have
Junior.
A nice grade of hair, uh-huh. what's the
Junior
measurement
nice
of forehead?
Hair.
If that's forehead that is allowed without anybody saying anything. And the reason I'm saying this. Because I'm seeing a lot of nice hair and a lot of huge foreheads and on men. I'm seeing it on men.
Well, he got
and
a
I
Texas,
need to know what's the...
He got his Texans yes. hat on today, so you can't see what it is.
This about me? Not...
Uh-oh. Junior! Uh-oh.
No, he said he had two different questions for two different people.
No.
Junior, can we just say this, Steve? Junior's
he said
fine. There's some guys... Yeah, there's some guys
only
on
one
television.
Got hair are you?
I don't have no hair, but I'm not talking about
you. Junior got hair. That, look at that. Junior, hold your head up. See how far back that is?
Junior's fine.
Is it reclining,
yeah,
though?
Yeah, Junior's
well,
in good shape.
It's not. See, yeah. your hairline is back up with your headsets.
What?
No,
perpendicular to his
Junior's
ears.
But Jay said he wasn't talking about Junior.
Yeah,
no,
I know.
I wasn't
what?
Talking about
that's
Junior.
Not, no, that's not me.
Well, let me be specific. Let me be specific.
Pussy.
Let me be specific.
Pussy.
Yeah, that word. One is a commentator, and without calling it, one is a commentator, and one. Is a comedian and there's two people. It's two people. It's not
what?
One people. It's two people. Okay.
Well, who the hell is the damn comedian?
I'm not
his
talking about you,
his
Junior.
Manager, Rashawn.
No. I'm not.
What?
No.
Harvey.
Oh,
Fulmer.
Oh,
yeah.
God.
Yeah. Rashawn and Stephen A. Smith.
I'm not talking about Junior. I'm not talking about
well, that. I'm just going with who all we all know. So who is we talking about?
We done messed up Jay's bit.
He said commentator. That's Stephen A. Smith. He said comedian.
Far,
former comedian was Rashawn.
I
how
know,
far back
nope,
is that?
Nope, nope.
All right, coming up in 34 minutes after the hour, we'll have more on the Steve Harvey Morning Show right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
50-year-old hip-hop legend and Houston's own rapper Scarface, we all know him. Well, Scarface just got a lifeline in his battle with kidney failure. Scarface had a serious case of COVID-19, which doctors say knocked out his kidneys, and he had to be put on dialysis. Scarface had made public pleas for help in getting a new kidney, but recently he told the world he'd found an answer closer to home. According to CBS News in Houston, Scarface's son, 30-year-old Chris Jordan, said, why not? He's my dad.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. So why not? On. He is my dad. Yeah. Scarface posted on social media a black and white picture of him and his son with the caption, "Someday we'll look back at this and laugh about it. Thanks to you, Chris Jordan. I'll be there too, a real superhero." Wow.
That's my dude, man. Yeah. Brad Jordan, baby. Yeah. Brad Jordan is my dude. Yeah.
Good guy. That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
A great father-son relationship, Steve. You know, I love what the son said. Why not? He's my dad, you know?
Mm-hmm. I mean, to me, it's a given. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, especially if you've been in your son's life. That's what the relationship is all about.
Right.
It's a given. Let me tell you something, man. On my Facebook show, speaking of kidneys, there was a black woman and a white woman that worked at the same hospital.
Mm. Okay.
They were talking one day. They met in the lunchroom and just introduced herself. We're talking. They said, "Girl, you seem sad. What's wrong?" She said, "My husband is in need of a kidney transplant." The white woman said, "Oh my God, my husband is in need of a kidney transplant too." But they couldn't find it.
A match.
They did some research, some medical things, and they said, "Well, what type of, my husband is a O negative, and my husband is an A something." Two, both of them had rare, and that's why they couldn't find rare bloods. Come to find out, the black lady was a perfect match for the white lady's husband, and the white woman was a perfect match for the black lady's husband, and all four of them transferred kidneys.
Wow.
That's a beautiful story.
From a conversation. Wow. And I just had that on my show. It's a crazy story, man.
That's so beautiful.
And I learned something about kidney transplants. When you get a kidney transplant, they don't take your kidney out your body.
Oh, they don't really?
They just add the kidney. So the white guy, this was his second one, he got three kidneys.
Oh, meaning the person that's receiving the kidney, they don't take the
They don't take a kidney out. They just put it
leave
in.
Leave it in.
Oh, okay, but the person
put
that's
the new one in.
I also heard the person that is donating the kidney, it's harder on that person, too. The recovery is very, very difficult.
So one person will have three kidneys, and then the other person will have one damn kidney?
You can live with one.
One. They say you can live with one.
Hey, yeah, but it don't matter what.
You looking at the dude that's got three. Wouldn't you be like, hey, wait a minute.
But one of them isn't working, Jay.
But one of them ain't.
Yes.
It's like, out of commission.
And what I learned about it was, it's certain percentage of kidney function. Like the black dude was now up to 72% function ability.
Okay.
I mean, it's crazy. I learned a lot that day. But that was an amazing story of love and commitment. Them two women met and was just sad that day, and they both found out their husbands needed kidneys. And then a few weeks later, they asked what some questions was. And next thing you know, each one of the women had the right blood type for each one of them's husband. And they both agreed to save each one of their husband's life.
And you gonna tell me God ain't real.
Come on.
Please, get up out of here.
Amen. Get up here.
Let me tell you something. They was having a spiritual moment on that couch. All four of them.
Yes. Yeah. I bet you they were.
White dude said, "Tell me nothing about God. Don't say nothing to me about him."
All right, well, coming up next, it is the nephew with today's prank phone call. right after this.
We might White well boy. Play. Can I have your kidney? I mean, yeah. We might well play that. No, we might well play. Kid. Can I have
Keep
your
on
kidney?
Going with it.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Coming up at the top of the hour, right about 4 minutes after, it's my strawberry letter for today. The subject, my holy lover's double life. Okay? Marinate on that for a minute. We'll get into that in just a little bit.
I already know what that's about.
But right now, you think you do. Right now, the nephew is here with today's prank phone call. What you got for us, Neff?
Well, you know, last break we was talking about the kidneys. You know, that's what we was talking about. Someone giving kidney. We talked about
Scarface
that.
Scarface and his son.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, I go in my archives and I pull out, can I have your kidney? Can
oh,
I
goodness.
Have your kidney? This one right here, dear to my heart, because this was my daddy's all-time favorite. Made me put it on a CD and made it play over and over again. So the whole CD only had Can I Have Your Kidney on one CD. It went like 30 times. He rolled around his truck, and he played this the whole time. Boy, if you just put it on a CD for me. This for you, Daddy. Can I Have Your Kidney?
Hello.
Hello, I'm trying to reach Brother Conley.
This is Conley.
How you doing, brother? This is Deacon Patterson calling from the church. How you doing today?
Deacon Patterson?
Yeah.
Just doing fine. And yourself, sir?
I'm doing good. You know, the church is behind you on what you're going through, and we praying for you, man. We know all about you going into surgery on Friday to get your pancreas removed. So I wanted to give you a call, man, have a word of prayer, and let you know that we all are pulling for you, and we know that the man upstairs is going to pull you through this success.
Well, God bless and keep you there, Deacon. God bless and keep you, because I tell you, I'm going through something here. Me and my wife, we've been talking about it, and we've been praying on it, and it sure is a wonderful thing to know that your church is with you, and y'all thinking about me in prayer. I've really had to take this to the Lord. This is a serious thing with me, and I ain't never had an operation before in my life, and
right,
know I need it. My wife done made it clear, the doctor done made it clear, and I believe I'm ready to go forward, Deacon. Was that Deacon Patterson?
Yes, that's right, Deacon Patterson. I've been in church probably about 8 months now. You pretty much been out most of the time.
Yes, sir. I have been out of here. Yes, I have.
So I've seen you a couple of times, but I wanted to call and put a word in for you and let you know that we're all praying for you at the church.
Praise the Lord.
Can't
Praise
wait for you
the
to
Lord.
Get back, and we know after Friday it's going to definitely be a great success.
Yes, sir.
And we're going to give the victory to who the victory is much deserves.
The victory to the Lord. Yes, sir. He's the victory.
Let me have a word of prayer with you, Brother Conley, if you don't mind. Just bow your head for me. Father God, we ask right now. We ask right now that you touch Brother Conley as he goes in on Friday.
Please, Lord.
Put your hands on him. We ask, Father, that you hold on to the doctor that's getting ready to go and put surgery on him.
Yes.
We ask that you make sure that the doctor has got a strong eye on that morning.
Walk with him.
We ask that he got a steady hand when he got the scalpel in his hand. We ask that you hold on to him,
please,
as he goes into his surgery, because we know come Saturday morning, the victory going to belong to Brother Conley and the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
We know all of this, but we ask that you take that pancreas and you remove it out successfully.
Please.
Close him back up like it was never been entered in before.
Walk with me, Jesus.
That's what we ask, and we ask you, Lord, at the same time, that they're removing this pancreas, Lord. We ask that you reach around his backside, and we ask that you touch his kidney, Lord. Touch his kidney and make it whole. Make it 110%. We want you to make that kidney like it's been the best kidney
Excuse
ever
me,
known.
Deacon. Deacon. That's Deacon. Deacon. Whoop. Pat Deacon Patterson.
Yes.
Oh, yes, sir. Ain't they, no, sir. There's nothing wrong with my kidney, Deacon. I'm doing fine. The Lord has done made it. Well, he's going to work on my pancreas. That's what the doctor's operating on. They done prepped me for it, and that's what they plan to remove. So my kidney is fine. They did what they called one of them MRIs, and everything else is fine. They ain't working on nothing but my pancreas, sir.
Right. Well, let me say, I'm glad you brought that up, because this wasn't really why I called you. What I want to ask you, and I know we've never met, what I was going to ask you was,
yeah,
and I know this is, I hate to come at you in the final hour when you're getting ready to go have surgery and all that, but if you don't mind, when they go in on Friday morning and remove that pancreas out, do you think that they could go in and get one of your kidneys? Because I need one.
Hold on just a minute, Deacon. What'd you say?
See, what is? I've been going through myself with a little ailment, and I'm wondering if I need a kidney, and I'm wondering if you can give me one of yours when they go in to get your pancreas. They already have you open.
Did you say you wanted them to take one of my kidneys?
Yeah, and give it to me because I need one.
You need a kidney?
Yeah. What you already going to be laying there open.
Wait a minute, mister. You need a kidney? I need help with my pancreas. You going to call me with some like that, man? This ain't no work of the Lord. Now, you say you a deacon?
Yeah, like I said, Deacon Patterson, my name. But see, what I'm asking you is, Brother Conley, what harm is it if you already open and laying on the table?
Oh, you ain't heard a thing I said, have you? I said, I'll be, man, you crazy as hell. Now, what I'm going to have to do, I'm going to need to call the pastor. Because, see, it's some going on here. You say you knew? You might have knew, mister. Matter of fact, you too knew to know who you're talking to.
What I'm saying is, you have two, like you said, you say they did the MRI.
I don't give a what I said they did, man. I got two kidneys, you got two. One of yours bad, that's your problem, mister. Let me tell you something. I'm trying to get well, and you calling with this. You say you a new deacon. You your ears, and you won't be at that church long. I tell you that because if I ever get close to your sister, we got some reckoning to do.
What is it going to hurt for you to give me one of them kidneys if both them kidneys is good?
It ain't going to hurt them thing because you ain't getting my kidney, man. It ain't going to hurt. What is wrong with you?
Say, man, all I'm saying is if you're going to be open and laying on the table, what is it going to hurt for you to give me
one? Oh, now you're going to tell me I'm open and laying on the table. What kind of a prayer are you in charge of, mister? Let me tell you something. Obviously, I need to meet you before I get to the hospital. And maybe I can help take out that bad kidney of yours. I can tell you that. We can it out. You won't feel a thing. How about that? There's too many games going on in the church today. I'll be if you're going to call and talk me out of one of my kidneys, man.
I'm trying to live just like you trying to.
Let the Lord take care of me because what you talking about ain't got a thing to do with Jesus. You can kiss my and get off my phone. That's what you can do.
Can I say one more thing to you?
What?
Is you listening to me?
Man. I done listened to you, and you ain't talking about nothing. That's got nothing to do with what's going on with me, mister. You running a game? If I could get to you, I'd put lead in your
mouth. Can I just say one more thing, and then I'm going to let you go? Is you listening?
For what?
This is Nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show. You just got pranked by your daughter.
Oh, Lord have mercy. That girl, Lord have mercy. Lord have mercy. Jesus.
You all right?
Please forgive me. Lord have mercy. Woo! Y'all, I'm going to have to. Lord have mercy. My heart is palpating here. Lord have mercy, Jesus. Mister.
Brother Conley, I got to ask you one more thing, man. What is the baddest, I'm talking about the baddest radio show in the land?
The Steve Harvey Morning Show. Man.
My heart is palpating. Come on, boy. That's my dude right there. Boy, you got my heart palpating. I was my dude.
What? Right in the middle of the prayer, he cussed you out.
Hold on. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. What's wrong with my kidney?
Hey, Deacon Patrick, hold on. Ain't nothing wrong with my kidney. Now, my kidney fine. I'm going in to get my pancreas removed.
That's what the doctor said. They did one of them MRIs.
Yeah.
See, that's what they prepping me for. Ain't nothing wrong with my kidney. You want what?
King of pranks. That's why you are.
He became.
See? All right, nephew. Well, thank you. That was funny. Coming up next, Strawberry Letter subject, My Holy Lover's Double Life. We'll get into that right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
Time now for today's Strawberry Letter. And if you need advice on relationships, dating, work, sex, parenting, and more, please submit your Strawberry Letter to steveharveyfm.com and click Submit Strawberry Letter. we could be reading your letter live on the air, just like we're going to read this one right here, Poppy. Right now. Yeah, and you never know. It could be yours. That's for
you. You never know. Buckle up. Hold on tight. We got it for you. Here it is. Strawberry letter.
Subject, my holy lover's daily life. A double life. My holy lover's double life. Dear Stephen Shirley, I'm in a three-way love affair with a man that is my pastor and my marriage counselor. I went to my pastor a year ago to get spiritual guidance so I could stay on the straight and narrow in my marriage. I was thinking about cheating and had one foot out the door. My pastor is married, so I meet with his wife on Wednesdays for spiritual guidance, and I meet with them both once a week to overcome the boredom in my marriage. Over the course of a few weeks, my pastor found out about my past life as a dancer, and he used it to his advantage. He told me that if I can make amends with my past and put it behind me, I would be able to be a happy housewife. He told his wife that it's best that he and I do one-on-one sessions, so I started seeing him alone. He had me do an interpretive dance for him, which is basically a striptease without taking my pants off. I could tell he was aroused, so I lost my mind temporarily and went over to give him a lap dance. From there, we went back into the closet of his office and I closed the deal with him. He's been paying me for dances for the last 3 weeks, and not only did it fire up something in me, I realized I am sitting on my real moneymaker. Although I'm 36 years old, I'm still in great shape, and I have all I need to get the bills paid. Pastor is a lot happier, too, and he has told me that my marriage will never work because my husband lacks self-esteem and can't deal with a sexy woman like me. I love my husband and the stability that he provides, but the pastor is well endowed and makes me feel like myself again. My holy lover has a double life, and I'm so confused about what I should do. Should I end my affair with my pastor? Should you end your affair with the pastor, you ask? Well, you know what they say if you gotta ask. And I'll answer you this way. Do you want to go straight to hell? Is that what you're aiming for here? Straight there? Is that what you're trying to do? Because you're stripping for your pastor, okay? I don't know if you've completely wrapped your mind around that. Of course, he of all people should know better. I mean, not only that, and instead of leading you to Christ, he's corrupting you in the worst way. I mean, nothing about this is right. You know this. Nothing about this is godly. Nothing about this is Christian. Nothing about this is helping you in your marriage. Nothing. It's just wrong on every level. I mean, there's some things in life that you should know that you should not do, and this is one of them. There's nothing redeeming in this letter. And I just got to say it again. You're stripping for your pastor. You're lap dancing for your pastor, your married pastor. The same pastor who talked badly about your man, said he had low self-esteem, can't deal with a sexy woman like you. Or excuse me, I'm sorry, was that supposed to be counseling that he gave you when he talked about that? I don't know. This is terrible. He's in no position, this pastor, to give you any advice. And I don't want you to be confused any longer because you say you're so confused about what you should do. You got to stop this, okay? Pull yourself together, girl. Think about what you're doing. You got to break up with this pastor. This is foolishness. Have you even considered that his wife may come in his office at some point or your husband may find out? How are you going to live that down? I just don't understand what you're doing. This is craziness. You gotta let this go. And the pastor does not need to be a pastor. Steve?
My holy lover's double life. To me, this letter is a lot about the pastor. Now, it's got a lot to do with her, but it's a lot about, well, it's a lot about both of them. Dear Stephen Shirley, I'm in a three-way love affair with a man that is my pastor and marriage counselor. What? Did
come on.
He's
come
your
on.
Pastor and your marriage counselor. You're in a three-way love affair with your pastor and marriage counselor. So he done counseled you. He done counseled you right into his arms. That's the counseling he did. I went to my pastor a year ago to get spiritual guidance so I could stay on the straight and narrow in my marriage. Now listen to this. I was thinking about cheating and had one foot out the door. You told him, the snake, the serpent, that you was thinking about cheating. You know what he heard? Oh, she wanna step out. Oh, I'm counseling this here. So then you said you had a foot out your door. Your pastor's married, so you meet his wife on Wednesdays for spiritual guidance. Now this is Wild Wednesdays right here. Cause you go down there on Wild Wednesday to meet with his wife for some guidance. The deed ain't nobody giving you information that you need. Once a week to overcome the boredom in my marriage. Wait, what? I'm confused. You go talk to another married couple to overcome the boredom in your marriage, but you leave your husband at home.
Right.
I don't understand how you accomplish getting over boredom when you taking up time to meet with them both and just her on Wednesdays. That's two meetings a week where you could be at the house being excited.
All right, I'm confused. Hang on, Steve. Yeah, hang on. We'll have part two of your response coming up at 23 minutes after the hour. Today's Strawberry Letter subject, my holy lover's double life. We'll get back into it right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, come on, Steve. Let's recap today's Strawberry Letter. The subject, my holy lover's double life.
My holy lover's double life and your double life, too. Hell, I'm a three-way love affair with a man that's my pastor and my marriage counselor. So he done counseled you right into his arms. I went to my pastor a year ago to get spiritual guidance so I could stay on the straight and narrow in my marriage. I was thinking about cheating and had one foot out the door. You told the snake in the grass that you didn't know was a snake in the grass yet, that you was thinking about cheating. Uh-oh, duly noted. Then your pastor's married too, so you meet with his wife on Wednesdays. We're going to call these Wild Wednesdays or Wacky Wednesdays. We having a wacky-ass meeting with the pastor's wife, which obviously ain't nobody giving you no valuable-ass information in none of these meetings. Because all your meeting that led to is an affair with the pastor without his wife. Because then you said you meet with them both once a week to overcome the boredom in your marriage. Over the course of a few weeks, your pastor found out about my past life as a dancer. You told him. See, you done gave this dude all he needed. Let's think about this. You done told your husband you're bored. You done told your pastor you're bored. You done told your pastor you was thinking about cheating. And you done told your pastor you was a dancer. Bing, 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 bing. That's the trifecta. He got it all. Lottery bells going off. I told him my past life I was a dancer, and he used it to his advantage. You add that into the fact that you want to cheat and you bored at the house. We got a problem. He told me that if I could make amends with my past and put it behind me, I would be able to be a happy housewife. I don't understand that counseling at all, but okay. He told his wife that it's best that he and I do one-on-one sessions. And her dumb ass thought that was good?
Yeah.
Okay. So I started seeing him alone. He had me do, soon as you got there, he had you do an interpretive dance for him, which is basically a strip tease without taking my pants off. This is so you could come to terms with your past and be a better housewife when he asked you to do the dance. I could tell he was aroused. Well, if you giving him a lap dance. You're going to be able to tell.
The worst.
You're going to be able to tell.
Yeah, you're going to be able to tell. Like, you know, like, it ain't like you psychic. I can tell you that right now.
You're stupid.
You lap dance, I could tell he was aroused. Like, you damn psychic or something. I can tell you right there. Anybody would have been in there would have knew that. Hell, a dude sitting next to him at the strip club know that. Anyway, I could tell he was aroused, so I lost my mind temporarily, and I went over to give him a lap dance. And then from there, we went back into the closet of his office, and I closed the deal with him. Now, this old fool been paying you for dances for the last 3 weeks. And not only did it fire up something in me, here we go, I realized I'm sitting on my real moneymaker. He done asked you to come to terms with your past. And obviously the thing you came to terms with was he done brought it back to current. So now what you used to do, he got you now doing for him. Because guess what? Although she say I'm 35 years old, he'd been paying you for dances for the last 3 weeks. And I'm 36. I'm still in great shape, and I have all I need to get the bills paid. I thought you was in there for marriage counseling. You ain't said nothing about you was broke. You did not mention you was broke. So now somewhere in the counseling session, you told him you was bored. You told him you was thinking about cheating. You told him you used to be a dancer. And somewhere in there, you done mentioned you ain't got no money. Right. And he done told you you need to resolve your past. So now he got you bringing your past to the present. Now you think you finna be a full-time stripper. Pastor is a lot happier, too. And he has told me, now this pastor, dog, my marriage would never work because my husband lacks self-esteem, can't deal with a sexy woman like me. But he can, because he paying. I love my husband and the stability that he provides. I thought you was broke. What is you dancing to pay the bills for if you love your husband and the stability he provides? What kind of letter is this? It don't make no sense. But the pastor is well endowed and makes me feel like myself again. My holy lover has a double life, and I'm so confused. You got one, too, about what I should do. Now, here's the golden line in this whole thing. Should I end my affair with my pastor? Lady, how that sound to you?
Right.
Shirley said, do you want to go straight to hell? I would like to add to that statement and say, do you want to go to hell with your pastor? Because I think y'all going on a buddy pass. That's what I think is going to happen right here.
Good one, Steve.
Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Post your comments on today's Strawberry Letter at Steve Harvey FM on Instagram and Facebook, and check out the Strawberry Letter podcast on demand. Now, coming up at 46 minutes after the hour, you know what time it is. Junior and Sports Talk right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, guys, Junior is here with Sports Talk. What you got, Junior?
Week 2 of the NFL yesterday. Well, let's get to the games and the scores. I know Uncle Steve pretty want to get to one game in particular. I'm pretty sure that's what he's waiting on. New England over the New York Jets, 25-26. We
picked
had
it.
You did. 23-13, Denver over Jacksonville.
Picked it.
Buffalo at Miami. Oh, you got to get Buffalo over Miami. Yeah, that was a good game.
Picked
too.
It.
San Francisco over Philly.
Had 17-11. I was pulling for Jalen Hurd on that one.
Yeah, didn't pick that one.
One of my frat brothers come through. Can't ever pull against a frat.
Hey, man, it's all good. 27-24, the Rams over the Colts.
Picked it.
You sure did, Unc. 26-17. How about the Las Vegas Raiders? Yeah, over Pittsburgh Steelers.
Oh, yeah. Oh, hell yeah. I picked that out of hate.
Yeah, you did. Yeah. He picked it out
for the Steelers.
Yeah. Here go another one you picked out of hate. Cincinnati fell to Chicago 2017. You picked that
out of pure hate.
Hate Cincinnati.
Man, the Carolina Panthers over the New Orleans Saints 26-7. What in the world?
I didn't make
happened?
That one. I don't know what the
My husband
happened
is
there.
Devastated.
Who that?
Man, I know that was a tough one. Didn't know what James Winston was going through out there on that field. Arizona Cardinals over the Minnesota Vikings, 34-33.
Picked great it.
He showed
boy, I was
did.
Hot this week.
He was hot up.
Woo!
Tampa Bay Buccaneers destroyed the Atlanta Falcons 48-25. Yeah, he did.
Hot this weekend, boy. Go ahead, Junior. Y'all
is.
Better start following me because I ain't picking no more because you just in my city.
Tennessee Titans over the Seattle Seahawks, 33-30 in overtime. Come back.
I didn't get that one.
You were supposed to pick that one, Nashville.
Yeah. Hold on. Here go another one. Dallas Cowboys over the Los Angeles Chargers, 20-17.
And didn't even want to.
Go ahead, Cowboys.
Yeah, man. Congratulations, Cowboys. Got their first victory of the season. Kansas City Chiefs fell to the Baltimore Ravens, 36-35.
Fumble. That one.
Oh, man, that was a quick game. And the way it ended, fumble by the Chiefs. It was 30-something seconds left on the clock. All right, man, that was Lamar Jackson's first win over the Kansas City Chiefs against Patrick Mahomes. And here goes
the
game.
Oh, you're trying to run out of time.
Yeah.
We're out of time.
Browns.
We're out of time.
Over the Houston Texans, 31-21. There you go.
30 seconds.
Yeah, 31-21, Cleveland Browns over the Houston Texans. And you did pick that one.
Ain't you from Houston, Junior?
Yes, sir, I am, sir. Yes, I am. Yes.
Carla, you from Houston, but you got to go with New Orleans. Don't worry about you. Tommy, ain't you from Houston?
You know damn well I'm from Houston. Why you doing that? What do you want?
Don't even start
what do you
that.
Want?
That's why we whooped that ass!
We'll be back with more Thank You, Junior, of the Steve Harvey Morning Show
booty spanking,
right
booty spanking. A big booty. Booty spanking, booty spanking. Big booty.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, guys, so... Did you see Tyler Perry post pictures and a few videos of this big moose? I mean, this huge moose that was in his backyard.
Yes,
it was so big.
I saw it.
Yep. I saw it. It was so big. Tyler was at home writing and saw this moose. The moose tore up some of his patio chairs, and Tyler said to the moose, "Can you go? Do you need an Uber?" That thing was big, but it was majestic.
But let me tell you something. You can't go out there.
Why?
Because moose are mean, man.
They're mean animals.
Really?
They some mean-ass animals, man.
Really?
Take all them pictures. Dog, they are evil. They don't play. They will kill you. Oh. Moose in Alaska kill a lot of people.
I did not know that.
I didn't either, wow. Shirley.
I just, yeah.
He looks so cool. He just
I know
like
that, like
roaming
that,
the grounds
yeah,
or whatever.
Like that
he's
beautiful
huge,
Omaha
though.
Moose.
Yeah.
Huge. Yeah. All right, so.
That's a big ass moose, though.
It is huge. Thank you for sharing that, Tyler.
Whoa.
Everybody don't have moose problems, though.
What is that? Right? So, Steve, Jay, Tommy, Junior, I got to ask you guys, have you please share if you've had any funny encounters with animals? Tommy, I know you have with the squirrel or the opossum or whatever it was.
Oh, yeah. I whooped my own ass behind that possum.
What happened?
Y'all already know the possum story. You know, I was on my way to the studio in Los Angeles at 3:00 in the morning. I'm trying to get there. I don't want to be late. Uncle Steve gonna talk about me. And I had a little 240ZX. The little sunroof pops up, and there's a possum on the fence behind my car. And I'm like, what I'm gonna do? What I'm gonna do? So I said, I'm gonna get in on the passenger side. I get in on the passenger side. And man, when I got in, that seat, I don't know if you know nothing about 240ZX. When you close the door, the seatbelt retracts. And that seatbelt, automatically, that seatbelt came down the side of my face. And I thought that possum had come through that popped up sunroof. I was throwing them hands in that car, man. I was swinging. My knuckles was bloody. My face, the greatest ass whooping I have ever taken, I gave it to myself. I beat the living hell out of me.
Scary, boy. Black people, why are we so scary?
If we scared of something, it ain't no joke. It's no joke.
We gonna play with a couple of them animals.
No.
You have one, Jay, Junior.
Yes, I did. I don't know if you know this, but my son had a dog. It was a pit bull. A pit bull with a nervous condition. So you got that right there. This pit bull had, his name was Gator. He was the sweetest thing ever. He's a good dog. He really was. But these cats, I had a big fence around my backyard, and Gator would be in the backyard. For some reason, these cats would go get other cats to go, "You want to see a dog lose his damn mind? Come here. Come watch this." And the cats The cats would just sit up on the fence and watch Gator just lose his ever-loving damn mind. I mean, they would go get other cats. Hey, man, you want to watch a crazy pit bull? Come over here. Follow me. Look at this. Look at this.
Follow me. Not follow me.
But Jay, they knew he couldn't get up there.
They knew he couldn't get up there, man. Oh,
nah, I ain't got one, man. Nah.
Junior, I know you got
one. I'll tell you what about my dad. My dad, we was going to my football game. And my dad, he had a Nissan 242, Tommy. And we was in the car, and he said, man, I love you, son. He said, man, I'm so proud of you, man. You're going to have a great game today. So I looked down. It's a guard snake on my side of the car. Soon as I said snake, he put the car in park and he was down the street, left my ass in the damn car. I didn't climb the seats. I got my hand up against the back of the hatchback. Daddy, all I see is his pants pockets. His ass is down the road. A white man in a pickup truck had to let me out.
All right, guys, thanks for your animal stories. We'll have more of the Steve Harvey Morning Show coming up at 20 minutes after, right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, guys, so here's a fun question for you. What if someone got your iPhone? What would they learn about you? See, right there.
My iPhone?
What would they learn about you if they got your iPhone? The first thing they realize.
I'm going to have to stop working here. I'd have to stop working. I'd have to find another place to work.
Is that bad, Jay?
I'd have to come to Steve and go, hey, man, look, it's been nice.
They got my iPhone.
You're about to heal some.
They got my iPhone. And Steve would go, I understand. I understand.
Yeah.
Oh, he very understands.
If you get in my cloud, I've been trying to find my cloud. If you get in my cloud, it's pretty much a wrap. I'm done. If you get
your
in that cloud.
Your career is over.
It's going to rain that day.
Done, Tommy. It's finished.
But the question is, what would they learn about you? What? So, why is it a rap?
It's just a lot in that cloud. It's a lot.
Well, for me, it's not so much other people. It's some things I'm doing that once they saw that, I mean, it's woo. It's,
what? It's Jay, what
you know what I think?
What? I think. Get your friend.
I had to wait till we come back. I ain't got enough time.
All right. We'll be back in 33 minutes after the hour, right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, so Steve, before we left, we were talking about if someone picked up your iPhone, what would they learn about you? Would it embarrass you?
You know, I think the most shocking thing about finding my iPhone
would be
the contacts. I think people would go, how did he know all these bishops? And he cussed as much as he cussed. What? How he got?
It would be embarrassing.
How he got all it? No, it'd be embarrassing.
Archbishops.
I'm talking about dog. Famous ministers, man.
Rabbis.
And when I run into a situation, man, dog, I got rabbis in my phone. I ain't gonna lie, man. I mean, I got some big boys, man. I got Islamic leaders in my phone, man. I got big pastors and Christians. I'm talking about, listen to me, man, top level. I'm talking about people go, wait a minute, you have whose number?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Do they know you talk like this? Yeah. I try not to let them hear.
But surely you do not curse in front of the pastor.
I have.
That's a shame.
I have. I've cussed in front of Bishop T.D. Jakes before a lot of times. He just laughed.
He can preach. Lord.
Oh, man, let me tell you something. Here's a true story. Okay. We were at Glenn Staples Church in the Baltimore area. Mm-hmm. And I was a speaker that day. I didn't know that Bishop Jakes was a speaker on the show. I didn't know. So I spoke, you know, wasn't nothing, not no Christian message. I just spoke, thanked them for having me. And Bishop Jake was next. So I'm sitting there with the dude that used to cut my hair. And Bishop started talking, and then he started preaching. We're sitting on stage, we're in the pulpit now. And the dude next to me, he taps me and he said, dog, is I'm crying. I mean, he said, dog,
is
dog, dog. Is, no, that's what he said. He from Mississippi.
Say, am I crying?
No, he didn't say that. No, he from Mississippi. Tears, I mean, his face was soaking wet. He tapped me. I'm emotional. I turn around, I look dead at him. He said, dog, is I'm crying. I said, yeah, you crying? He said, man, I can't stop. This the coldest dude I ever seen, man.
Ooh, you can preach.
And when Bishop Glenn Staples brought him on stage, he said, ladies and gentlemen, I introduce to you the greatest preacher of all time. You know, you hear that. But let me tell you something, man. I kid you not. Bishop T.D. Jakes is the greatest preacher I've ever heard. If you want to talk about preachers, this is that dude, dog.
Yes, all right, Steve, we'll be back to do our last break of the day. And of course, you'll have some closing remarks at 49 minutes after, right after this.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.
All right, guys, here we are, our last break of the day. Jay?
It is the last break of the day. Put your mask on. We might have one for you. No mask, no last break, okay? How about that?
Put your mask on.
I like it. All right, Steve.
You know, I often talk about your mental attitude. I'm going to share something with you because it's a way that I was thinking of how I really thought. And I was thinking about statistics and how statistics, people use statistics to help them be okay to me with their failure. People use statistics to find a way to describe their lack of movement or they're not being successful or something. Because you got to be careful with any stat that says one out of. You know, you ever hear a stat? One out of every 5,000. One out of every. One out of every. Six out of 10. See, and people, if you're not careful, statistics can be very crippling. 30% of the people who do this will wind up that way. And what negative people do, they automatically put themselves into the negative side of the equation. Because if you're accustomed to thinking negative, you will always take the negative side of a statistic. One, they told me years ago, one out of every 2,000 comedians will get on the Tonight Show. So that means 1,999 comedians out of the 2,000 will never get on the Tonight Show. So you know what everybody around me was talking about? Man, we'll never make it on the Tonight Show. You know what I did when I first got in comedy? I hummed the Tonight Show theme song before I went on. I hummed it. I never got on it with Johnny Carson. But you know what I got on the Tonight Show? When Jay Leno was on there. But I was already successful. That's the only way I got on it. But see, I never allowed that statistic to enter into my system. We having trouble getting vaccinated right now because people are going at the statistics. What happens when so-and-so take this? It's amazing what statistics do. Be very careful, you all listening to statistics, because they got nothing to do with you. They don't. Stats to me are for people looking for a reason to explain why they're not going to do it or why they didn't make it or why they're not successful. I don't care nothing about no stats. See, the problem is what I chose to do, and let me explain this to you, see if you can get what I'm talking about. Let's look at these two words. Let's start with probability. What's the probability of you becoming rich one day? What's the probability of you being able to have a child. What's the probability of you hitting the lottery? What's the probability of you owning more than one house? What's the probability of you being able to travel like you want to in this world? What's the probability of you seeing four other countries before you die? You understand what I'm saying? Once you look at the probability, you are in trouble. Because the operative word in probability to me is probable. It probably won't happen. Well, it's probable, but it ain't likely. That's the problem with it. So I never operate on probability. I choose to operate on another word, possibility. I only look at the possibility of it. And here's the cold part, y'all. If you thought about it for real, listen to this right here. Do you realize that it is impossible to think an impossible thought? Uh-oh, what did you say? I said, do you realize it is impossible to think an impossible thought? So if you thought it, do you not understand that that's possible? Show me one person. Show me anybody. Show me anybody that has thought an impossible thought. How can you do that? How? How can you think an impossible thought? The reason you can't think of an impossible thought, because the moment you think it, there lies the possibility. And now it opens up your life. It opens up your realm of thinking. It opens up you to starting to begin the process that anything is possible. Anything is possible. Do you know something? That you could really be rich one day if that's what you wanted. Now, I'm not saying that's a necessity or that's what makes you happy. I'm just using that as an example. Do you know you could actually have more than one home? Do you know that you could actually drive more than one or two cars? You can have four cars. Do you understand that you actually can help change lives that you've been thinking of changing? Do you know that you actually can become a business owner? That you actually can open up that business? You can actually do it. You can actually do it. But you got to fix your mind, because it's possible. Stop looking at the probability of something and look at the possibility. And if you tell somebody an idea all the time and they start telling you why it won't work, stop talking to them people. You don't need them people. I only talk to people when I give them an idea. They go, yeah, man, we can do that. I don't need you telling me how it won't work. The opposition gonna present itself in everything you attempt to do anyway. I don't want to hear your mouth talking about why it won't work. I only get myself around people when I give them an idea, they say, yeah, man, let's go. Those are my closing remarks. Ain't no more.
Okay, then.
To have a Christian day.
For all Steve Harvey contests, no purchase necessary, void where prohibited. Participants must be legal U.S. residents at least 18 years old unless otherwise stated. For complete contest rules, visit SteveHarveyFM.com.
You're listening to the Steve Harvey Morning Show.